Hey folks, it's Ted Cantu with a Miracle Mindshift. Today is December 23rd. Some of you, that means Christmas. To me, it's day 65 on the subconscious mind program that I'm on. I'm determined and dedicated to rewiring my brain to the subconscious level. And coming in, there's some amazing miracle shifts that are actually happening. I'm taking this trek personally because I tell you what, when I lay this information on you today, you're going to probably want to do it too. Instead of going with the flow, I'm actually going against the tide right now, like a salmon swimming upstream. I'm not going with this flow. The arguments, the fighting, you know, the holiday stuff that I detest so much, the sizing up and the finger pointing and all the accusations and all this stuff. I just, wow, you know. And I always say, you don't need more family time. You need less family time. And that's what we say here on the Miracle Mindshift, because it's all about you. It really is. And if you're a people pleaser, you're not going to like what I have to say. I did a show, years ago with a rabbi who talked about memes. And I'm not talking about the little funny stuff that you put on Facebook and Instagram, the memes, or Twitter or whatever. I'm talking about frameworks. The frameworks that you create around you that support your belief or keep you imprisoned. And these are thoughts about what your home is like, what your family's like, who your family is, and all this history. I just got a thought. I'm going to write it down real quick. Don't let me forget. But here we go. This pen's not working. Got to throw it out. Before I forget, this one's not working either. Somebody up there doesn't like me. Because I don't want the story getting out. I have a feeling I know who it is. The Cantu crystal, don't let me forget that. This is actually a part of your personality that you got to fix. So the memes that we surround ourselves with will actually help define who we are. We had this idea that you can't change your environment and the environment always wins. That's what the rabbi said. This particular rabbi, not all of them, but that's what this particular rabbi has said. And what's funny about that is it's not true. At least I don't think it's true. And he says, you can never beat the environment always wins. So if you are living in clutter and you're living in a very condemned social situation and you say, there's no way out of it, that's your life. You're stuck with it because you made it. That is not true. And that is not what we believe in. And I'm sorry, Rabbi, I just don't believe it, because I found evidence from Dr. Joe Dispenza that talks about the mind, subconscious mind, reprogramming your mind to break the habit of who you used to be. You can break it. And a lot of us are addicted to ourselves. So what I'm saying, like, let's say, for example, well, this Christmas is not so great because we're hardworking people. And historically, and I'm just going to use my name hypothetically, the Cantus were never really affluent. And so we're hardworking people, but we're good people. We love God. And there's a considerable mercy of being poor in spirit, for we will inherit the earth and the treasures in heaven and so on and so on. You're making excuses for who you are. And I cancel what I just said. That's not me at all. I'm all about affluence. Life, as big as I can get it, and adventure. Still, I have not outgrown it. And that is who I am. That is who I will, that's who I'll always be. But I want more of it. And that's why you're watching the show today. Now, here's the thing. You can cancel your environment and become something bigger, but you got to change three things. You got to change, number one, your environment, obviously. Your idea of your body, your movement, your energy. It's got to be more dynamic, and you got to change the time that you're in. People get stuck in time. They'll say, I was big in the 80s, I hate it all the time. The 80s was such a wild time, and the 90s were too, kind of, not as much, but I think the 80s were really probably a bit bigger, with this idea that nothing could be outrageous enough, and there's nothing that can be bold enough. I think that idea kind of went away in the 20s, the 2020s, and the 2010s, musically too, culturally. It just wasn't anything. Not like it is, like it was then. But we get stuck in this time period where we actually think that, things are actually bigger. And why try to be bigger than that now? Because I already had my time, and now I'm just going to be an old man. You see this on Facebook all the time. Like, 36 years ago, this album came out. 40 years ago, this came out. Don't you feel old now? No, not at all. Not at all. Change the time. Get addicted to living in the now. Embrace the spirit, the Holy Spirit, as a guidance. Move forward boldly, boldly in your faith. Things will shake up and move. And breaking the patterns that define you. Now, let me go back to the Cantu crystal story, because that is funny. My stepmother, I hate to call her that, she was my dad's wife. She wasn't really a mother to me. She was my dad's wife. I had this box called the Cantu crystal, and she made it sound like, you're not one of the cool kids. You'll never own this. You'll never own the Cantu crystal. Ooh, the Cantu crystal. I want my hands on that. What am I going to do with it? Seriously. So I'm like, what are you talking about? And my family never collected crystal, never. None of them. So I get this box and I'm looking at it. And what she had done was she's gone to this J.C. Penney's. Looks like J.C. Penney's was doing this thing. And there's four goblets, and they're god-awful ugly goblets with like medieval shields on them. Now, first of all, I'm not even like from the UK. I'm actually from Michigan, but they had these family crests on there, like we were either Irish or we were like Welsh or some sort of like an English nobility, or Spaniard. No, not Spaniard. It was more UK, I think. And there was like a lion on there. There was like a little castle, a little crest, a little shield, and there was four things on there. I thought that was really, really weird. And I thought, what the hell is this? And I thought, that's the Cantu crystal. And one day you may own them, but not today, because today, they belong over here in the, I don't know, what, she put them in the mantle or something. She was really proud of them. And I thought they're like the most hokiest things I've ever seen in my life. Anyway, life happens. She died. Actually, no, I'm sorry. Their relationship died. And my dad got stuck with them. So he got stuck with this box. And they were just taking up space. And he was cleaning out his house one day. He said, here, son, take these. I don't want to see these anymore. Because they were divorced. And the Cantu crystal. So I took it. And didn't want it, but I took it just to be, just to like not extend the conversation. I just took the box, put it in my car, drove it home, and forgot about it. And one day I put them in my shed and I forgot about them. Maybe a couple of years went by. And I just remembered all these horrible memories that I had of being in that family. And I just decided one day, I don't want to deal with it. I don't understand this whole exclusivity of, you're not good enough, you're not entitled to have these. But now it's kind of like, now it's somebody's garbage, and now it's my garbage. Not only just garbage, but just the mental energy that's tied around the Cantu crystal, bullshit theology, whatever that was. I didn't want to deal with it anymore. So what I did was I grabbed a hammer, I took the goblet out, laid it on its side on the cement, took it, and I smashed it, the first one. And that felt pretty good. I thought, you know what? I'm gonna do it again. So I pulled out another one. I smashed that one too into little pieces. But the third one broke that too. And the fourth one got rid of it. Well, and what's funny about that was, and I realize that now as I'm older, is that you can actually attach energy around physical objects, things that bring you bad memories, and pull your body down because you're conditioned to believe in negative frameworks. Will actually release chemicals from your brain into your body, making you sick, giving you psychosomatic illness. Dr. Malt, Max Maltzwell, I'm sorry, Max Maltz, Dr. Maltz, right? Maxwell Maltz, psychocybernetics. Okay, there we go. And that sort of thing. But also good feelings, endorphins can make you actually well. Now, and Dr. Dispenza talks about some guy who gave himself cancer because he was not living up to his family's expectations, made himself very, very unhappy. That happens. He went down to the beach, I want to say Maui, some tropical island for 2 weeks. Came home, grabbed one of these, wrote down his thoughts about the whole experience, and was able to cancel out all the negative feelings and just embrace all the good feelings. Just that alone, he got rid of his cancer. Wow, how about that? Yeah. Don't let these people make you sick because they're mentally sick or they just don't like you for whatever reason. You don't have to accept that. I don't have to embrace that, take that on because someone doesn't like me and I got to take on their negativity and wear it like a cloak and unleash unhealthy cells that attack my vital organs. Not doing it. You say, he's not respectful. He doesn't respect us. He doesn't respect his elders. Damn straight. I don't. Not a little boy anymore. So, take a hike. True. How do you do this? Hebb's law says it like this. Your nerve cells and your brain will fire simultaneously. Yeah. And it'll put in a mental state, good or bad, and that becomes your mental signature, hence your personality. Now, my notes are scribbly here, so I'm going to change notebooks. This is the one you want to get your hands on right here. This is all my good stuff right here. Day 65. Okay. And we're talking about actions, thoughts, and intentions. Kind of reminds me of that song, ATV. What was that one? The punk song. I forgot the name of the group. It goes action, time, and vision. ATV is the way to be, or something. Kind of reminds me of that. Actions, thoughts, and then and intentions, which is actually your vision of how you want to live and what you want to do. Now, what's inside the inner world, inside your body, is going to come out on the outer world and it's going to materialize in front of you. And then you're going to go, wow, my environment's not so hot because what's going on in here? My outside world is full of clutter and confusion. And it makes me depressed. It makes me ill. And you can get ill like that. Yeah. But it's interesting too. Catherine Ponder says you can actually clean your environment, think feng shui, right? And when you start to clean up all of the clutter, it releases the thinking to go into a positive direction. That's the universe right there. And of course, bring it back to a scripture level. The devil likes confusion. Satan likes confusion. He likes to have things tangled up in a mess, always in a flux of just confusion, sadness, disorientation, because he thrives in that area. And I say, clean it out, clear the way, and do it. Now we say, clear the way. There was a prayer we used to do, and I was with, I've studied like 20 different churches, But there was one that always said, you know, clear the way, clear the way, clear the way. And we would chant it, but faith without works is dead. So if you don't actually do the work, you're still going to have it. Speaking it isn't enough. You got to take a physical act, physical action. And that's what I did with these goblets, these worthless, stupid goblets that were meant to like put a poison over me and make me feel like I'm not good enough. That was the legacy. And I got rid of it. Action. No more bad thoughts. That's the second one. Thoughts. No more bad thoughts. After I took action and got rid of it, my intention was just to eliminate the BS. And I did that too. Actions, thoughts, and intentions working together makes change. Yeah, that's true. Now, your inner world and your outer world, they're inseparable, right? You can't think one way and actually expect things to work out another way. The devil likes it when you think good thoughts and you occasionally slack off and do a few bad things. He likes you in the middle. That comes from Yehuda Berg. He talks about that in his Kabbalah books. And that's interesting. That's the position. That's the stage he likes you in. And I think this other idea, too, is that I can vent. I can yell. I can, you know, communicate angst or anger because I'm human, right? I know people that think like this. And I stopped doing that because I thought, I don't want to operate in that space. I don't want to operate in that space. Love is the highest energy. Now, I'm not one of these hippie guys that say love, you know, like the love guru or Peter Zaremba and the love delegation from the flesh tones. I don't know if you remember those guys. I understand the power of that. Lenny Kravitz certainly does. But my idea of it is to have this complete caring of other people and put yourself in a higher position where you really care about people on a genuine level, right? I'm not talking about sex stuff because, interestingly enough, in this book, what is it? Break the Habit of Being Yourself. There's a graph in here that shows where the sexual energies lie on a scale of things. Love's on the top. Believe it or not, sexual feelings are way at the bottom, right along with guilt, shame, anger, resentment. I mean, it's like one of the lowest energies. True. This is according to one author. You may have your own crazy ideas about what it is. And I know I've studied enough yoga and I've been to enough talks where I can create some hate mail, which I'm used to. But I want to believe in that thought because I always believed that just these carnal thoughts was actually a low energy, just like any low energy of guilt, shame, indulgence, which would create, you know, a real low vibration. Great to have your ideas and thoughts verified by other sources. Survival emotions versus elevated emotions. Less matter, more energy. So the more love you have, it's a very, very top, so elevated emotion. In the middle is anger, hate, and judgment, guilt, shame, fear, and doubt, lust, and competitions on the very, very bottom. Wow. Survival emotions. Fight or flight. Wow. That's on page 103. So I don't know if you can see that, but we'll try to get a close-up of that graph because that is interesting stuff. So let me keep moving along my notes here. The four stages of operating and stepping out of your old self. You want to reach towards greatness. And everyone's done this. That is great. You're looking at people like Tesla, P.T. Barnum, Walt Disney, Thomas Edison, Mother Teresa, MLK, and so forth and so on. The four stages of change. Learning knowledge. Receiving hands-on, paying attention, and repetition. Learning new things is so important because it helps your, it helps the synapse of your brain to rewire itself and to become great. You have to do that. Otherwise, you're going to slip into some old patterns that are hard to break, if not impossible. And when you live with these limited beliefs, it creates the sameness. There's no change. To rise above. Now that's a funny one. Rise above. I'm thinking Black Flag, the punk band who had a song called Rise Above. That's not what this is. The Black Flag version says something like, you think that I'm a loser, but one day I'm going to rise above, and, you know, you think you can disrespect me, but I'm going to rise above. It was something like that, some facetious babble. But that's not what this is. Rise above by learning new material, learning new concrete thoughts that elevate the soul. That is what this is about. And nothing is impossible because your brain is going to react on this great new idea that you want to set forth, and it's going to be hungry to want more and more. Receiving hands-on experience with your new knowledge. Live it. That's the best way to learn anything. And through repetition, it stays with you when you pay attention to the right things. That's how you change your brain. And if you actually let go of your ego, which is only 10% of your brain, let go of your ego, you activate the other 90%. Which can actually grow, think, outmaneuver your old self. Don't worry about your competition. That's why it's on the lower level, along with the sexual identity. Competition shouldn't even be in your vocabulary unless you're competing with your former self. You want to break your former self, step out of who you used to be, and rise higher. Neuropeptides and the hormones, those are really cool. Neuropeptides are in the brain. The hormones relate to what's in the body. So let me give you an example. Neuropeptides. All right, this chemical. Somebody cuts you off on the road. Happens every day in Detroit, especially if you're driving behind me. And a big Ford, because you think you own everything, a big Ford truck, right? F-150 or whatever that thing is called. You always get on my bumper. And instead of me blowing up, right, I'm not going to react. Because this neuropeptide up here is going to come down to my survival mode in my body, attach itself to an emotion, which is actually going to be one of aggression. And I strike back. And I do something crazy, and I cut the car off, or I slam on my brakes so he can grind his gears. This is Detroit, man. This is what they do. I don't support it at all, but this is what they do. All of a sudden, I'm going to have problems. Same thing goes the other way. Neuropeptide right here in my brain. Okay. I know I'm tired. I want comfort. I want to go lay down. I don't, because now I want to do something that's family oriented and do something nice for my mother. I went out and made some cookies for her. Didn't have to, didn't want to. I was tired. I got her the best eggnog money can buy from Guernsey, the dairy. I got it for her, and I made her a nice snack on her night off. And then I went to bed. But it made peace. See, I have a whole new loop that when I do the loop, it can make amazing outcomes. Instead of saying, well, I want comfort. It's my night off. I want to get out of here for a while. I had enough family stuff and go to the bar down the street, which I used to do in my 20s. I'm not going to lie to you. But how many good things can come out of that loop? There's not a whole lot. And there could be some legal trouble there too. If you hang out with the hooligans that I grew up with, I won't even go there. We feel the way we think, and then we think the way we feel. We feel the way we think. But it's more important to think about the way you could feel. Because you start making different choices at that point, and you start making different types of observations, like me serving my mother, which is pretty interesting. Yeah, choose your options. And then we can start to choose our actions and our feelings to command our results. That's the force. You wanna see that scene? What is that? Those goofy movies, man. I love Star Wars. I love the first ones, but then they start getting really bizarre. But like when anybody used to ask Anakin, young Darth Vader, what kind of action do you want to take? And he would say, I suggest patience. Let's try patience. Well, it is true, right? But if you actually choose that, you get to actually choose your outcome too and what's going to happen afterwards. I think that's a little more interesting than just to kind of go with the flow, right? So, but we could also choose to be angry when somebody, comes after us. We're ready for war. Once a neuropeptide hits your adrenal glands, you're ready for war. Or somebody says something really horrible to you. How do you want to respond? Fear or action? Wow. So, when you get this type of power in you, the idea of wishing for stuff doesn't really make much sense, because you can command your environment. You can also command your brain. The idea is to live beyond the three areas, again, which is environment, body, and time. If I act in proactive ways that strive to do the right thing and go way out of my character, I'm living outside of my time. Because my time, when I'm here on Earth, is just a culmination of what I know. But if I live outside of my time, I can make change. That's why so many career, criminals go back to prison, because they stick to a plan. They're hardwired with this software of who they are. I just read this thing about this guy. I think he had like 93 shoplifting charges. It was in the news. I just saw this like today. And he got out and he did it again. Just like within 24 hours, he's out. He's arrested again. It's amazing. So, the other part I'm starting to understand is uncomfortable giving unleashes the light. Now, this is really interesting, because the last thing I wrote in here was about our state of being. So thinking and feeling is actually memorized. If we never think greater than how we feel, we're going to stay stuck in time. Stuck in time, which is something I don't want to do. I don't know if you want to do that either. That's why resolutions don't work after on the New Year's. People say all crazy things. I'm going to lose this weight. I'm going to lose that. But it's starting to create habits for yourself. That's what really creates the change. That what gets the momentum going. And how we approach it, what we can make a memory into a habit, is how we're going to approach our problems. Based on that is where the change comes from. I had miracles pop up. I had some sales come in that at the last minute before Christmas, which is really incredible. You wouldn't think of doing business a couple of days before Christmas, but especially in Michigan, where it's excuse city, because you know it's coming in January, right? If you're from here, everybody and their mother goes to Dubai for their birthdays, and they're gone for 2 months. Everybody, I don't care if you're making $20,000 a year, they're going to Dubai, supposedly. And I know that's BS, because I know a lot of broke people. But that's the story that they told themselves. There's no real change going on there. You know how I know? I buy these people lunches. I call them the sandwich club. I know that when I step into a restaurant with these people, I have to foot the bill if I got to hang out with them or I got to buy them coffee. They never buy me stuff, ever. And in fact, a lot of these guys I stopped hanging out with. I tell you that in confidence because that's how people are. I also know that we can be conditioned by different dogma and rhetoric that's open for interpretation. And we stick to these lines and hold them as truths without making really any substantial change. If you're tired of living frustrated and broke like that, then you might want to give our office a call. I don't know how long I've been talking here. I got to probably take it easy. And yes, I guess I'm close to my end time. So I just want to leave you with these thoughts. That escaping yourself is the best gift you can give yourself. That's the best thing you can do for yourself. I'm going to keep it simple and let this end for now. If you have any questions, and I'm sure you do, you can always contact me direct at tedcantu.com. And you can also get a hold of me at 248-277-6141. That's my phone number. And then my email is tedcantu@gmail.com. And I want to wish you a happy holiday season from all of us here at the WIN and the Miracle Mindshift. And remember, if I can overcome my problems, you can too. This is Ted Cantu. Until we meet again, thanks for watching, and I'll see you online.